So today we will spend some time discussing the midterm paper, and then we will continue with more matrix problems, very fundamental matrix problems, some of which you might have seen before, like Gaussian elimination, solving linear systems of equations, and finding determinants of matrices. So in discussing the midterm paper, the first question was supposed to be pretty much giveaway if you were tracking the course. It's basic index games so that you get a pattern of crosses in an ASCII art. So the very first pattern is fairly obvious. What's going on is every alternate position is being filled in. And therefore, it's not difficult to see that row plus column is the deciding quantity. And you check the parity of that. If it's odd, you do something. If it's even, you do something else. Now, your code doesn't need to be exactly equal to this code. For example, instead of checking if row plus column is even, if you check if it's odd and do the correct thing, that's perfectly fine. And instead of dividing by 2, if you mask with the bit pattern of all zeros and a 1, and then use that, that's equivalent. So don't worry about those things. Generally speaking, in exams, we will not insist on completely correct syntax from start to finish. There is no need to waste time and space talking about what files to include and all that stuff, okay? Even defining main as such, unless main argv argc is required specifically, okay? For most of the problems in, or for all the problems in midterms, you didn't need to give anything except the code logic. We avoided problems involving characters and strings and got right down to the basics. Okay. So the first pattern was fairly simple. The second pattern was a little more non-trivial, and that's why we gave a template code. So in the second pattern, you see that it's like a diamond with four corners which are grayed out with X's, and then there's a center. Okay. Now, the important thing about the coordinate system here is that you print rows in increasing order going downward, and columns are increasing as you go to the right. That's half opposite to what you see in a Cartesian plane. Okay? So I didn't want to miss the pattern itself, so I'm going to use the board. So the coordinate system is almost like here is your column, here is your row. Rows increase downward, columns increase to the right. And in this coordinate system, if you think about the upper left corner, that corresponds to some kind of a half space. Okay, clearly the equation of this must be row plus column less than equal to something, or less than something. Similarly, the other corner, that half space, has to correspond to row plus column greater than equal to something. Okay? It's removed from the origin. Now the other two corners have to use a difference between row and column. And that corresponds to the four lines in the template. So two row plus columns and two row minus columns or column minus rows. So at this point, all that's left for you is to figure out the polarity of the comparison and the right-hand side of the comparison. Okay. The left-hand side bool clearly tells you that some comparison operator has to happen there, and the pictures themselves, you know, make it clear. And all that remains is to figure out what those right-hand sides are. Now, we've already defined nn and half for your convenience. And so it's easy to see that if this is about half-half, then the first equation has to be row plus column less than equal to half or thereabouts. Okay. And you can similarly figure out all the other ones. If this is about half, double of that is nn, then clearly this thing is going to hit the axis at something like nn plus half. And after this, it's just a problem of making sure that you don't have this off by one errors, that after dividing an odd integer, you're doing the right thing. And you do that by considering one of these examples. And you figure out that the southeast corner actually has nn plus half minus 1. You have to adjust that. And that's it. All the others are exactly comparisons with half. Okay. So once you work that out, these two problems together shouldn't have taken you more than, say, 15 minutes at most. For people who are running along fairly well with the course, it should take them like 8 minutes, okay, at most. So the first question was supposed to be reasonably a giveaway question. The second question is slightly more interesting, and I initially set it to use vectors, but then if people were not comfortable with it, I changed the spec so that it used native arrays, so that even people who hadn't studied vectors in much detail could easily solve number two. So what is question number two? You are given a polynomial where many of the coefficients could be zeros. So it's a sparse polynomial. And therefore, the way to store it is to use two gang arrays. The first integer tn stores the common length of the two arrays. And then you have powers from 0 through tn minus 1 store various powers of x. And coefs of I will store the corresponding coefficient, which could be positive or negative. The coefficients are floating point numbers. The powers are integers, okay, positive integers or non-negative integers. So as you can see, the very first power may be 0. Okay. And that's the only subtlety about the question. And we gave a couple of examples where p equal to 2 minus x cubed plus something x to the power 5 is represented with three terms where the powers are 0, 3, and 5, and the coefficients are the corresponding numbers. Okay. So after reading up to this point, you should be very clear about what the representation is. And then the first question was, how do you differentiate these kinds of polynomials? And again, the only subtlety is whether there exists a constant term or not. If there is no constant term, then the size of the arrays, the logical size of the arrays will remain the same. Every coefficient will be multiplied by the corresponding power, and each power will step down by one. So that's well understood. And the problem case is where you have a constant term, because the constant term on differentiation will disappear. And to represent this in this representation correctly, what you'll have to do is to eliminate that and squeeze down everything else from the right, one position. Now, again, there are multiple ways of writing this. You could either detect the presence of a constant term and explicitly do a block move in the two arrays, which would be fine. A slightly smaller and simpler piece of code is given here, where you create a write cursor and a read cursor, as we have often done in examples in class. The read cursor marches along from left to right. The write cursor always lags it. It's either at the read cursor or it's one behind. It could be one behind in case the first constant term is discarded. So you start off wx and rx both at 0, and then they march down the indices. Rx is always incremented in every iteration of the loop, but you modify wx only if the power was positive, strictly. Okay? In which case, you write out to wx, and then you advance wx. Now, at this point, after the for loop ends, wx is either the original tn, if there was no constant term, or it's tn minus 1, if there was a constant term. In either case, you write wx into tn, and that fixes the logical length of the arrays that you should look at. Okay. So again, fairly simple problem. Can't imagine taking more than like 15 to 20 minutes for this at most. 2b was more non-trivial. So 2b basically said, if you have a symbolic polynomial represented in this fashion, and also there could be large gaps in the power sequence, so you could have something like, you know, 1 minus x plus 3x cubed, that's just dropping x squared term, but you could have, you know, x to the power 15 minus 2x to the power 29. Okay. So if you have such large gaps in the powers, then how would you efficiently evaluate the polynomial at a given floating point value of x itself? So px is symbolically given through those two arrays, and now I instantiate x to a specific value, evaluate px for me, and return a float or a double. So the very simple way to do it is to build up the powers needed as you go along. So you build up x to the power 15, starting from x by multiplying x 15 times. And then in case the next power is 30, then you need to multiply another x to the power 15. So you keep multiplying, okay, in arithmetic progression order. Namely, you multiply with 1x at a time. And that, of course, takes linear time with the powers. So that takes a long time. And this is the very simple code for it. You just track the last power you have seen, the maximum power you have seen so far. And if the next power you have to compute is larger, then you keep multiplying by x until you reach the next required power. And then you, you know, take care of the coefficient here. Okay. Now, we've already seen in class that this is a slow way to do exponentiation. And you could do fast exponentiation by squaring. And this is what it does. Okay. Any confusion? Yeah? Am I going too fast, or is my voice not clear? Okay. So the faster way is to bridge the gap between adjacent powers by squaring. Okay. So if I just saw x to the power 15, and the next power I have to construct is x to the power 30, that means I have to build up x to the power 15 again, and I do that by doubling. The same doubling trick that we saw in class. So we pretty much use that as a subroutine to build up gap power. So gap power is the next power I need minus the previous power I have. And then, you know, we use the doubling trick to bridge gap power. And then we multiply by the gap value. And then we update max power to the next power. Exact same code, but just the bridging of power to next power is done by doubling or squaring. Yes. Yes, that is already stated. So, in strictly increasing order.
Can we use the power?
Well, if you use the power function, you'll lose a little bit of credit. But if it's correct, we'll give most of the credit. So, in correcting all the midterm, all the exams, the general policy is that correctness is paramount. And efficiency is sort of secondary. In some questions, we will highlight that you need to get the most efficient solution. But generally, if you use library functions like POW, then you are invoking log and exponential inside, which is pretty slow. So roughly speaking, we might deduct something like 10% to 20% maximum in such cases. So here, the very first solution, which uses linear building up of powers or uses the POW function, will get some baseline marks like 75 or 80%. Say 80%. And then people who do this the squaring trick will get full marks. Okay. However, the squaring application here is not the best possible. There is actually a slightly more elegant way to evaluate the polynomial based on squaring, but in a slightly different way. That solution is not here. If you would like to work on it and submit it as an extra credit homework, you can feel free to do so. Okay. From linear time to squaring, of course, buys you a lot. But from this form of squaring to the slightly cleaner form of squaring may not buy you that much. It's maybe at most a factor of 2 speed up. So we didn't put any marks for that. What we are thinking of doing is certain questions, if they're answered particularly elegantly by students, they'll be flagged for a coding competition at the end of the semester. Okay. And based on that coding competition, we'll decide the A pluses and, of course, also other marks in the class. But anyone who answers this question in the third way, which is not stated here, will be flagged for the possible A plus. Okay. There's also been some discussion on the missing project and what we're going to do about it. Some people want to do projects, but the point is it's going to be very non-uniform. The backgrounds and what you want to get out of the course is so different for different people that it's pretty hard to standardize projects. It's already hard enough to standardize the 5 labs in a week. Being fair while evaluating projects is basically impossible. So what I was thinking about is why not try a quiz 2 first, or quiz 1.5 say, which is actually a lab quiz, okay, with a much longer time base. So we'll take some weekend and have a 3-hour lab exam, okay, without much time pressure. Right? Because limited time exams, you have to write some code in, 10 minutes or 20 minutes, which is correct. I won't get it correct most of the time. So we'll try that out. And we'll try it long before the official quiz 2 deadline. So that if we see it's messed up and it's not working and people are complaining about various unfairnesses, then we might drop back to the written quiz 2. Or we might have even both. Okay. That way we'll reduce drastically the total weight on the finals. And we'll have a bigger part of the evaluation based on no time pressure lab coding. So this has been expressed by the other section, and we are seriously thinking about that. But either through the 3-hour lab exam or through a sort of extra credit coding project, we want to have more not regularly evaluated coding work in the class. Okay, solving puzzles can only get you so far. Okay, the third question is about needles and haystacks again. But the only difference here is that neither needle nor haystack is sorted, and they can have lots of duplicate entries. Okay? And the goal is to remove any occurrence of anything in needle from haystack, but keep the other elements of haystack unchanged. In particular, if there are other duplicate elements in haystack, they should remain unchanged, and the ordering should be kept the same. Okay? So for example, if haystack had these numbers in it, and needle was basically the set 2 and 3, you would remove all occurrences of 2 and 3 from here, but you would leave the 5-1-4-1 unchanged and in that order. Okay? So generally speaking, you should realize that sorting haystack is kind of useless because I have to report the surviving elements in the original order anyway with repetitions. Whereas sorting and deduplicating needle is a good idea. Okay, I might have given you needle with 1,000 elements but with only 3 distinct values. If you first sort them and then squeeze out all the duplicates, your needle becomes only a 3 element array. And searching it is much faster than searching 1,000 element array. Okay. So that's one observation. And other than that, I provided all the primitives here and I alerted you to revise all this before the exams particularly as well. So the simplest code will just scan haystack left to right. And for each, it will check whether the character or the number is in needle or not, and accordingly, it will just squeeze out the values one by one if it appears in needle. But the problem is that if you squeeze out gaps in haystack one by one, you might be copying the same items multiple times. Okay, so you shift a block, then you shift a block some more, and so on. So a better technique is to, again, have a read and write cursor. Because you can only lose elements, you'll have the read marching along ahead of the write. And the read reads a particular element of haystack. If it is not to be eliminated, you write it on the write cursor and advance both. If the red element appears in needle, then you advance it without writing anything in the write cursor. Okay. So it's fairly simple. All you say is read cursor from 0 to the size. If I binary search for the haystack rx in needle from beginning to end, and I don't find it, then haystack write x plus plus is haystack rx. So here the write cursor advances, and then you resize it to the final size of the write cursor to discard the junk elements at the end. Okay? This resize is of course important, otherwise you have junk elements at the end. Now, so I sorted needle, but you can also deduplicate needle in pretty much the same way. In fact, deduplicating needle after sorting it is even easier because all you have to check is that as you are reading along, you have to only write values which are larger than what you last wrote. Otherwise, there's no reason to write it. Okay. So that's the comparison here. If either wx is 0 or needle wx minus 1 is not equal to needle rx, then append the next value to needle itself. Okay, this is a trail behind write cursor. So again, you give the first algorithm, you'll get about 75% to 80% of the credit. If you give the second algorithm, you'll get full credit. Okay. In this case, there's nothing particularly smarter that you can do. The last problem is mathematically the most fun. And there are two pieces to this puzzle, both of which were covered in either a class or a lab. We have, of course, discussed permutations and cycles in them at great length in class, including showing how you can circulate the values in a cycle by one step. So all that should give you sufficient background on what it means to find cycles in permutations. And the second piece of the puzzle was this lab exercise for one of the sections where we looked at planets rotating around a star, and each planet has its own periodicity or year. If at the beginning all planets are aligned in one line with the star, when will that next happen? That's the LCM of their years, right? So between the two of these, you should have caught on that if there are multiple cycles forming the permutation, and one cycle has periodicity 3, another cycle has periodicity 2, and so on, after you apply the permutation an LCM number of times, all cycles will fold back to their original position. Okay? So it's a combination of finding cycles from a permutation and finding their LCM. Okay? But even if you didn't get that last piece, there are enough other parts to the question that you should have gotten. So we start off with finding the inverse of a permutation, and that's pretty easy. If a particular item I goes to pi I, then all you have to do is to take pi I back to I, and that's what's being done here. Okay. So inverse pi takes pi I to I. And this will all work out fine because the permutation is bijective. You'll fill up every cell exactly once, and nothing will go wrong. The second is about repeated application of a permutation. And this one, there's no coding to do. It's just to get familiar with the idea of applying a permutation again and again. So if you take the sequence S, which is just A, B, C, D, E, and you apply pi once to it, you get this sequence. If you apply pi one more time to the second line, you get the third line. And the question was to just keep applying it for, say, 7 steps. And the intention was that you apply it 6 times, and you notice that you have come back to the original order, A through E. Okay? and that should tip you off about what's really going on. Because we have talked about cycles so much that it's pretty easy to pull out the cycle manually. And then you observe that there are exactly two cycles, one of which is of size 3 and the other is of size 2. And you fold it back after 6 iterations. So that should tip you off as to what's going on. Okay, that was the intention. So, and after that, 4C basically said that if you don't have S to start with, but you only have to compose pi k times, how do you do that? And that's not difficult. So this is very similar to walking a cycle. Okay, you just don't care about whether it's a cycle or not. You just walk along, okay, k times. And that gives you pi to the power k. And 4D is that last one, which is you know, how many powers do you need before you fold back to the identity permutation. And here again, if you do an exhaustive search by actually applying pi and checking, you'll get some marks. We'll decide exactly how much. But if you do it the smart way by taking cycles and then figuring out, you know, when all the cycles line up in their LCM, then you get full credit. Again, there's nothing particularly smarter that you can do in this case. But I wanted to comment about one last thing about cycle finding before I moved on to today's actual content, which is when we discussed pulling cycles out of a permutation. Suppose I have n elements. The union of all the cycles has n elements. And there is no reason that you cannot list cycles one by one in a total time which is proportional to n. Okay? However, there is one small technicality there. And in class, I wrote bad code. In this solution, the code has been fixed. So let me explain why the code was bad and what the fix was. Suppose I have this permutation of n elements, in which the first cycle involved the first n over 2 elements. So it's 0 to 1, 1 to 2, up to n over 2, back to 0. Okay. So this is the first cycle. And then there were some trivial cycles involving pairs of elements like this. Okay. Now, in my earlier sloppy code given out in class, what did you do? We had a bit array marking what elements have been already covered by cycles already reported. Right. So as I traverse this cycle, I marked off that bit as visited for all the first n over 2 elements. And then, remember, we looked for the first unvisited element to pull out the second cycle. In this case, how much time would that take? I would skip over n over 2 visited guys, and then I'd find the first unvisited guy at n over 2 plus 1. So I'd take about n over 2 time. And then I'd cover the next two elements, and therefore n over 2 plus 2 elements would have been covered. I would again start from here, that's the mistake. I'd again scan, this time up to n over 2 plus 2. For the next two cycle, I would take time n over 2 plus 4 to get there, and it would increase this way, right? So this is roughly n over 2 terms, each at least n over 2. So the total time taken would be about n squared over some constant. Okay? And that's silly, right? Because why should I always start from the left end to find the first unvisited element? Okay? So that's the wrong thing to do. What I should do is I should maintain a permanent marker at the first unvisited thing I last found. And when I need another unvisited element, I should advance that. And remember where I left it off. Okay, I should never start from the left again. Otherwise, I'll take n squared time doing a job which patently takes only n time. Okay. Now, one important thing is that if you look at how it's written, it might appear like in the worst case, we might still take n squared time, but this marker that I'll put up here will only advance to the right. And therefore, the total amount of work you'll do advancing the marker will never be more than n. Okay. So this often happens. You might, in non-trivial code, find nested for loops. And unlike all the analysis we have done, where we just multiply the number of iterations of the outer for loop with the inner for loop, you can't do that. Because the inner for loop may actually depend on the position of this cursor, which never goes back. See, when you look at other nested loops that we have looked at, like going over the rows and columns of a matrix, you can have the column snap back to zero and the row advance. If that cannot happen, then you cannot just multiply the number of iterations in the various loops to get the overall time. So let's look at the code now in light of that information. So I keep a unvisited to do my cycle tracing, but I also keep a next. So this next points to the next unvisited element. Okay, and this next will only increase, it will never decrease. So forget about the other stuff like LCM and so on, that we know what's going on. So visited is this bit vector, which is all false. No one is visited initially. And while num visited is less than the size, this is the key loop. So I say while visited next plus plus next. Okay. So if next is pointing to anything that's already visited, next will be incremented until it's positioned at the first unvisited element. Now there is no danger of running out of platform here because I'm doing this only when unvisited is strictly less than size. So there is always at least one unvisited element and next will lock into that place. Okay? So you don't need to check the value of next when you do other stuff. You can actually use next without fear. Now you do a cycle begin at next and then you keep going. Right? Now looking at the code very superficially, it might seem like, well, unvisited is going up one at a time in certain cases. And then inside I also have a plus plus next, so this looks like a nested loop, each of which might go through n values, but it doesn't take n squared time. Because you observe that there is no decrease in next ever. Next can only increase. Okay. So sometimes you need to argue about loops in this way, and your actual complexity might be less than what the for loops will superficially suggest. Okay. So that was the midterm. We'll look at the distribution of marks. I'm basically expecting this time that the median should be more than 50% of the total. So it's 16. And I don't want to scale this down. The quiz one, I scaled down because people performed somewhat below my expectations. But this one, I'm basically thinking that some people will miss question four. Most people will get some parts of one, two, and three right. One, I do expect you to, you know, everyone to get. If you didn't get one, then you should worry a bit. Okay. Two and three would be a mixed story, and some people will get some parts of four. So let's see what it turns out. I'll publish the distributions of quiz one and midsem after the crib sessions are over, so you get a good idea of where you stand on the curve. Okay. Any questions about midterm? Yes? Okay, so we have fairly important material in matrices today. We will be talking about Gaussian elimination, determinants, and a few other algorithms. So where do we leave off? We talked about eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and the math of why it converges to the dominant values. And we wrote some boost code for finding the dominant eigenvector. And the last thing we started doing is least squares fit. Okay. So I'll just recap that quickly, and then we'll move on to the next problem with matrices. So remember that we started motivating it by saying, suppose you want to fit a model for the execution time of a program you're writing as a function of the input problem size. Okay. For example, if you want to load n elements from a file into your program's memory, and then you want to sort it, our domain knowledge about computers by now tells us that a program has a roughly constant time to get loaded in RAM and start up. Then it reads the file of n elements from disk, and that takes time proportional to n, with some constant that we don't know. And then you sort it, and depending on the sorting algorithm, you might take n squared time, or you might take n log n time, but those things have constants in front of them. If you're sorting, say, integers, that constant may be smaller than if you're sorting strings. Right. And of course, in case of strings, it depends on the average length of the string and many other factors. But the idea here is that if you have observed quantities in your artifact that you're studying, like the size of the array, the speed of your CPU, and things like that, that goes into the matrix called X. Okay? Those are observed variables. Or suppose you're trying to predict if someone has a risk of a heart attack. Okay. For that, there are various predictors, whether the person has parents with hypertension, what's the food habits of the person? Do they take enough vegetables or they take high fat food or high calorie food? Do they exercise regularly or not? So that these are factors. Okay. So every factor becomes what's called a feature, and that's a column in this matrix called X. Okay. In our coding example, the features were n, n squared, n log n, maybe a constant. Okay. So we assume that x's are always padded with a constant column of 1's just to get the offset correct. Okay. Now, after that, you also have training observations. So while you're trying to learn the pattern of hypertension and heart attack, suppose you have patients who have documented histories of heart attacks, or you also have healthy patients. Those go into this vector called y. Okay, these are the predictors. These are the observed training examples of what you saw in actual patients or in actual runs of your code. You measure the running time and that's your y. Okay. What you're trying to learn is a predictive model called w, which linearly combines those feature values into a predictor for y. And you'd like to fit w so that you make very accurate predictions. And the way you do that is you want to minimize some kind of difference between each xi times w and yi. Okay. So the actual objective you have written in non-matrix format is sum over instances xi dot w. This is the prediction. And this is the training observation. This is observed squared. Okay, that's why it's called the least squares fit. And that exact expression has been rewritten in a matrix vector notation here as xw minus y's L2 norm squared, or equivalently this product of a vector and its transpose, inner product. Okay. And after that, it's all just vector and matrix algebra. And we wrote this down in a quadratic form. And then we said that, well, in this case, there exists a closed form value of w called w star, which minimizes that divergence between predictions and observations. But it turns out that w star involves inverting this large matrix called x transpose x. Now today and the next lecture, we will learn how to invert matrices, and many of you may know it already. But supposing you don't know how to invert a matrix or it's too expensive, okay, then how do you solve for w star numerically without doing an inversion? And that's where we use Newton-Raphson, namely, you know, at every step you start, you know, we start with a guessed w, and in every step you update the w. Because you want to minimize the objective, you find the gradient of that objective function and go in a direction against the gradient, in the direction opposite to the gradient. Okay. And that's this equation. So you find the gradient and you subtract some arbitrary constant called the step size against the gradient. Now, when you do this and you use an arbitrary step size eta, you always run the risk of overshooting. So again, to give you a brief picture, in one dimension, a quadratic surface to minimize looks like this. Okay. And let's say I'm initially here. So the gradient says the function increases to the left, therefore I'll go to the right. But suppose the step size I take is too large and I go here, okay, I may in fact even increase the value of the objective if I go far enough. So your step size should be smallish. We don't exactly know how much yet. But suppose you go here, you have overshot. Now you find the gradient again. The gradient goes this way, therefore you have to come back. And maybe you overshoot again. But you do that, and then you end up at the value. Okay. In 2D, the shapes may look a bit different. In 2D, it's like a bowl, and you land a marble at some periphery of the bowl, and it rolls down to the bottom. It may overshoot, of course. Right? And what's the shape of the bowl? Depending on that quadratic term, so remember we have this term W transpose XW, so look at this as some matrix A. Okay. Now, and then some linear terms, maybe of the form W transpose B. Okay, I'll drop the constants. So in 2D, suppose W has only two dimensions, I'll call them W0 and W1. What does the surface look like? Let me draw some contours. If A is symmetric and there is no B term, in certain cases, the bottom of the valley will look symmetric. Okay, so each ring is higher up than the ones inside it. And in this case, optimization is said to be a little easier. The more difficult case is where you have a minimum, but there are highly elongated elliptical bowls. The bowl is very elliptical. It's very flat in one dimension and long in the other dimension. Okay. Why is that? Why is this bowl a little difficult? Here, a single choice of a step size will typically do okay. Here, if you are here and you find the gradient going that way, you can actually afford to take a long step size. You'll not overshoot by much. But if you are here and you take a large step size, you'll overshoot to a large objective. So finding the best step size is quite a science. And there have been, you know, books and books on finding the step size. Now, one way to look at the problem in this particular problem is that I have a parabolic bowl. If I've already decided on a direction of descent, then I can slice the bowl along that plane. And that actually gives me a parabola in 2D. Now it's just a parabola. So I can always hunt for the lowest on that parabola in closed form by solving a one-dimensional parabolic equation. The problem is that that's as complicated as finding the inverse of the original matrix. So the big question in this area has been, you know, I don't want to invert matrices. I don't want to store inverses. These are all bulky, difficult things to compute. But I would like to, by magic, find the best step size, large enough that I converge fast, but small enough that I don't overshoot. Okay, that's the central problem in convex optimization. Okay. And you'll, some of you will take many advanced courses on optimization. We'll learn much more about it. But finding a step size is a very, you know, tricky art. So I won't discuss that. It turns out that in this problem, subject to very mild conditions, you cannot really go down. And we have seen that. You choose some arbitrary eta which is not too large, you'll do fine. You may be converging slower than optimally, but you'll be safe. Okay. Now, one thing is, you know, is there some kind of an upper bound? You can say, okay, as long as eta is less than that, I will not infinitely overshoot. And you can, it's not too difficult to derive that. Okay. But we'll leave it there. Okay. So and you sort of demo that you can find the optimal W at some point. Yeah. Which one? Which line? This line? This equation, is it, or something else? Oh. So remember my update equation said W at the next time step is W at the previous time step minus the step size times the gradient at the previous time step. This was already on the slides, right? So remember, all these W's are actually vectors. Okay, so this is a vector in some, say, 2. So those are the two axes. Here, W is just one thing, W0, and W is just a real number. So if you generalize your hunting for the minimum of a quadratic surface to multiple dimensions, you have to draw it in multiple dimensions. Here the minimum is a point here and the curve is shown like this. If I have to show a 3D parabolic bowl on 2D, I have to draw, do a contour plot. So these are contours. Okay, so it's like a valley and lines here are contours of equal height above the floor. Okay. So because it's a parabolic surface, any section through it will be a circle if the parabola is symmetric. But depending on the value of x, it may not be symmetric, x and b. You may have a parabola, a bowl that's squished in one direction. Okay. So in general, the contours would be like that. Okay, so today we start with, finally, start with determinants. And you have all read about school book definitions of how to compute a determinant. They are exceedingly complicated and I confess I've totally forgotten about it. Somewhere in my subconscious, there are these formulas which look like minus 1 to the power I plus j, and then something called a cofactor, which is, you know, you chop off the row and the column of the matrix, you do something complicated, okay? So determinants are never computed that way in real life. Okay. Determinants, the only practical way to compute a determinant uses these three axioms. Number one is that if you take a matrix, a square matrix, and then you multiply one row and add it to another row, the determinant does not change, okay? Adding, you know, scaled versions of rows to each other doesn't change the determinant. The second is that if you exchange two rows or two columns, the determinant changes sign. Okay. And the third is that if you are lucky enough to get an original matrix which was upper or lower triangular, namely all elements below or above the diagonal were zeros, then you don't need to work hard at all. You just multiply the diagonals up and that gives you the determinant. So given these three axioms, the strategy is very clear. It's very similar to Gaussian elimination. You have to keep on adding or subtracting, you know, scaled versions of rows or columns from each other so that everything below the diagonal becomes zeros, and then you can multiply the diagonals and report that as the determinant. Okay. So in pictures, here's the approach. Suppose I'm given this square matrix for which I want to find the determinant. The first row is gray and the second row is yellow. The first row is already done, there's nothing to do. In the second row, I would like to subtract some multiple of the first row so that A10 is taken to zero. Okay. So in other words, I'd like to find a factor F0 such that A10 minus F0 times A00 is equal to zero. So I'd like to find a factor for the first row which when multiplied by the first row and then subtracted from the second would reduce A10 to nothing. And you can solve this explicitly for F0, it's just A10 over A00. So for the first half of this treatment, we'll assume that we'll never fall in trouble by dividing by A00, in that the diagonal elements are never zero or negligible. Then we'll fix that assumption afterward. Okay. So in this case, once we do this subtraction, the very first element of the second row reduces to zero, and so I show that as pure white. And A11 and others change, that's fine. Now the first two rows are processed and done. We attack the third row, which has become yellow. This time we want to zero out A20 and A21. Okay. Now, zeroing out A20 is easy because only the first row can help that happen. And so F0 is just going to be A20 divided by A00. Okay. Now suppose we have already subtracted F0 multiple of the 0th row. That means that A21 minus F0 A01 minus F1 A11, the new multiple we want to find for the 1th row, that should be equal to 0. And now given F0 is known already, I can solve for F1 and get another factor for the second row. So I keep doing that. So after this step, both A20 and A21 have been zeroed out, and we attack the next row. We make the first three elements zero, okay? And we go on like that. Ultimately, we have an upper triangular matrix, and we just multiply out the diagonal elements and forget about the rest of the matrix. Okay? Yes? Yeah, so I'm redefining F0 all the time. So for every yellow row, I need to find a new set of F0, F1, F2, etc.
But sir, in this equation that you have A21 minus F0, A0.
Yes.
This F0 will be the old F0.
No. It will be this F0. So at every point, you should think of the F vector as bound to a specific yellow row that you're trying to zero out. After I'm done with a yellow row and moved on to the next yellow row, the old Fs are all forgotten. They don't matter. Okay. So how many people are already familiar or otherwise comfortable with this algebra? Okay, it's very, very simple. Okay. So let's write some code for this and see it at work. So the code is simple, but the index arithmetic needs a little bit of care. Okay, because eventually I have a pattern like this where in pictures, the general stage of the algorithm pictorially looks like this. So here's my matrix. I have already zeroed out something like that. Here is my yellow row. Okay. And I want to zero out this segment. Okay. And below is out of control, all kinds of junk. Now, so this is all zeros. This is already done. And that's final. So let's name this row as dx in the code. So it's the row where from column 0 to column dx minus 1, I want to zero out. Okay. Now, how am I going to do that? I'm going to subtract various multiples of previous rows, which I'll index by Sx to represent subtraction. It's the row to be subtracted, therefore it's the Sx. This is the row up to whose diagonal I want to zero, therefore it's dx. Now, when I do that subtraction, I'll need to run through columns and do the subtraction. So the column will be marked Cx as usual, when I need it. So those are the three indices we will use in our code. And here is what the loops look like. So the very first outer loop will cycle through dx. So dx goes from the first or zeroth row to size 1 minus 1. Size 1, remember, is the number of rows. Now what we want to do is to make a dx 0 through a dx dx minus 1 equal to 0 by suitable scaling and subtraction. Okay. Now how do I do that? Remember that in general I have to subtract everything, each row in Sx, indexed by Sx. So I start up the Sx loop here, int Sx equal to 0, Sx strictly less than dx. I have to compute the factor by which I have to multiply the Sxth row. And that's just a dx sx divided by a sx sx. Okay. This is the only important statement to watch. Okay. So dx sx divided by sx sx. So what is that? So I'm currently considering a particular sx here. And this is the diagonal element sx sx. And this is the element dx sx. So I take the ratio of those. So fac is equal to a dx sx divided by the diagonal at sx. And then running through the columns, I do the actual subtraction. That's fairly simple. A dx cx, c running from 0 to size 2, which is columns. A dx cx minus equal to factor times a sx cx. So there's a slight bit of jugglery with the indexes. You get one typo here, your code will be wrong. But once you draw that picture like that, it's not too difficult to get all the indices right. Okay, there's no tricky arithmetic here. Fine? And then finally, we multiply together the diagonals. Okay, everyone comfortable with this code? Can I get a show of hands, please? Okay. Yes. Question? Yeah? So let's code this up and try it on some input matrices. Now, so here is the code for determinant 1. Now, I start off declaring a matrix of doubles. Do you need the font any larger, or this is tolerable? At the back, is it clear? Larger? Okay. Yeah? So I declare a matrix of doubles, and then I read it in from Cin. This is one way in which Boost can let you directly read a whole matrix from one statement. Okay? How does your input need to look like? So here is an example of what your input needs to look like. You need to say the number of rows and number of columns. And then you need to state each row. Okay? So here is rows, columns, and the rows of the matrix one after the other. So this code is 1526, 4152, 7415, and 3741. So it's a 4x4 matrix, okay? And I can read it in one statement by saying read it from Cin, and I'll show you how that file can be fed into Cin, okay? And now it's exactly the code which I stated in the slide earlier, the dx loop, the sx loop, and the cx loop, okay? And finally, remember I had to multiply all the diagonals together, so I have product equal to 1, and then I run through the diagonals, multiplying them with product, one by one. Okay. And finally, I print out the product as the determinant. Okay. Now, since it's not good to trust one's own coding, I am going to fire up Scilab so that we can actually cheat and see what the determinant is before starting up our code. Okay. Could look at the code further while that cranks up. Right. Now, if I compile it, and meanwhile, here is Scilab. So let me look at the file value. So it's 1526. Let me enter that data. So I say A equal to 1526, next row, 4125, 7, 4, 1, 5 and 3, 7, 4, 1. Okay. Huh? Oh, 4, 1, 5, 2, thanks. Okay, so that's the actual matrix written down in row flattened order. It looks like that. Now, in Scilab, we could ask for the determinant of this guy just by saying det of A. So it's very simple. So determinant of A is minus 1176. Okay. We went in and found that. Now here, I'll say A dot out. But remember that this guy wanted to read the matrix from C in. But I have the matrix in this file called determinant 1 dot dat. So all you have to do is to run A dot out and use this less than symbol to say, whenever the program is trying to read C in, feed it bytes from this file. Okay. This construct will make this file look like C in to the program. Okay. So let's do that. And this is the runs going on. So see, in the first iteration is just the original matrix. In the second iteration, what happens is this 4 has to be zeroed out. And you can zero out the 4 by subtracting 4 times the first row. So 4 minus 4 is 0. Okay. 1 minus 20 is minus 19. Okay. 5 minus 8 is minus 3 and so on. In the next round, these 2 elements have become zeros. In the next round, these 3 elements have become zeros. Okay. And finally, the product of the diagonals does turn out to be minus 1176. So we have passed the exam. Right? Now one problem is that if I look at other kinds of matrices like this, like 1, 2, 4, 2, 4, 6, 3, 5, 7. Okay, let's feed that to Scilab and see what happens. So let's say B equals 1, 2, 4, 2, 4, 6, 3, 5, 7. Okay, that's a perfectly legitimate matrix as well. But observe that when I find the factor for the first row, okay, I'll find that I should subtract twice the first row from the second row. And in doing that, I'll zero out both the first element and the second element. And this will be a problem afterwards because my diagonal will go to zero. And in my code, if you remember, I was dividing by the diagonal here. And so I'll fall in trouble. Okay, so let's get a demo of that. Okay. So if I run the old A dot out on the second matrix, less than is required. This is what I get. After the first step, this 2 has become 0, but the 4 has also become 0. As a result, after that I get nans and infs because I'm dividing by that 0. So this is not acceptable and I need to have some recovery plan. On the other hand, if you actually look at the determinant value of this matrix, there's nothing wrong about it. The determinant of B is minus 2. So it's not a singular matrix, but the simple first attempt algorithm will not get it right because it will zero out the diagonal. Okay. So the fix for that is well known. It's called pivoting. Okay. So if a diagonal element DD or DXDX becomes too small in magnitude, then to avoid trouble, we look for a lower row, Z, where the DF column, ZD, is not too small. Okay. So pictorially, if I find that after I finish off, this diagonal element is almost zero. That will endanger the computation in subsequent iterations. And what I'll do is I'll look for a lower column ZX where this element is large or large enough. And then I'll swap these two rows. Okay. Remember, swapping the row only changes the sign of the determinant. I'll remember how many times I swapped, and that will be enough to fix the problem. Now, if it turns out that all of these are zeros, you can actually prove that the determinant is zero. Okay. So anyway, and there are various ways to do this pivoting. This is just one way. Now, let's see the modified code for that. So that is determinant 2, which is the exact same code, but I have this threshold, 10 to the power minus 7. In case, okay, so I do the exact same thing here. Now I check if pivoting is needed. So if the absolute value of A dx dx is less than the threshold, then the yellow line which I have just processed has fallen in trouble, and I find a lower row that does not have a near zero in the column dx. So I look for z or zx by initializing to an illegal value of minus 1. Then I run rx from dx plus 1 to number of rows. That's the scan down that column. And this time, I'm not very picky. I just look at some element which is larger than threshold, and I pick that, the first one I find. And I break the loop. That gives me a z or a zx row that's good enough. If that is minus 1, then we cannot pivot. Otherwise, I swap the rows dx and z. And swapping column by column is very easy. So I run a column loop again, cx. And I use a temp to swap a z cx and a dx cx. So the rows dx and z are swapped. But the important thing is that I have to reduce dx now because I have to reprocess that lower row. Okay, the important thing is that I took the trouble to zero out all these entries, but these guys could be non-zero. This has now come in this position. Therefore, I have to redo dx. Okay, so I reduce dx by 1 before going out of that check. Yes. Yes. But you can't even finish the operation because because an intermediate diagonal has become zero, right? You can't divide by it. Yes.
But sir, when giving the determinant, we saw that that became zero when it was minus 2.
Yes.
So, what we can do is probably this. When the very first element of a row, we can go to the very first non-zero element of that row.
Yes.
Take that into account and do this for every other.
Yeah, so you can swap ahead of time. Sure. You could do that. Yeah, yeah. Any linear combination is okay. You can do it in a way that you don't hit this trouble. There are many ways to avoid this problem. This is just one. It's not even a very good way. There are problems with this also, okay, that I'm not mentioning. So, you know, then if the pivoting happens, then you reduce dx and repeat the loop. Otherwise, you exit the loop. And then we find the product as usual. Okay. So now, how does determinant 2 behave? So g plus plus determinant 2 dot cpp. So now if we give it that slightly problematic matrix, what does it do this time? See, it turned this into 0, 0, but then it realizes the problem and shifts it down. So this 0, 0, minus 2 is gone to the last position, and this 3, 5, 7 came in and was rescaled to become, you know, part of the diagonal, part of the triangular matrix. And then if you multiply the diagonals, you get 1, minus 1, minus 2, its product is 2, but remember I have swapped a couple of rows, so that gives me minus 2 in the end. Okay. So determinant 2 is a slightly more robust algorithm, but it's not the best. You can actually do better pivoting, and in fact, there are cases where the determinant 2 will also fail where it shouldn't. So there are better, you know, more reliable pivoting algorithms which will be globally correct. The other thing you noticed is that I was just really picking any z which gave me a non-zero. But that doesn't have the best numerical properties. Okay, if you pick the largest one under certain settings, you'll get more stable algorithms. So you can improve the algorithm in various ways. But the summary is that, you know, you can compute diagonals, you can compute the determinant of a matrix nicely. So any question about finding determinants numerically? How much time does this take, by the way? Can you make an estimate of the time? Suppose pivoting is not happening all the time, but most of the time there is no pivoting or there is no pivoting. Then there are loops. The outer loop is dx loop, which happens n times. Inside there is the sx loop, which happens dx minus 1 times, but that's like n squared. Okay. And finally inside we have the column cx loop. That happens n times. So overall this is like an n cubed algorithm. Okay. The outermost loop happens n times, the second loop happens about n times on average, or n over 2 times on average, and the innermost loop happens n times. You multiply those, you get n cubed. Okay. So it's a fairly expensive algorithm. It's harder than sorting. it's takes more time than even selection sort. Now the next problem we'll look at is very simple, given we have already done this, which is to solve a system of linear equations. Okay. So how do you do that? Well, the input goes like, you are given matrices A and B, okay, or A and Y, where A is n by n and invertible, say, and x and y are n by 1 column vectors, and the goal is to solve for x. Okay. Now this is quite distinct from the least square problem, where we expected the W matrix to be actually quite redundant. The X matrix. So there the X observations had many more instances than the variables in W that you wanted to fit. Like if you think your sorting algorithm takes some time, which is a function of a constant n squared and n log n, that's just four things to fit. But you can easily run your code 500 times to get a scatter plot, and you're trying to fit the scatter plot. So least squares fit is by definition an overdetermined problem, whereas solving a system of linear equations is exactly determined. See, in least squares fit, you are expecting redundancy, and you want to minimize the divergence between xw and y. So your objective was to minimize xw minus y norm, but here we want exact equality. I want ax to be exactly equal to y. And therefore I can't afford to have any kind of a, unlike any kind of x which I saw earlier. See, subject to experimental error, your x could have been anything. You could have a lot of noise in x. People don't always get hypertension if their parents are hypertension. It's a completely noisy world, right? But here, it's totally mathematical. I want an exact fit of AX and Y. And therefore, A has to be much more controlled. A has to be invertible. A has to be full rank. Okay. So suppose A is given as an n by n matrix, and the goal is to solve for X. Now observe that whatever we have done on A so far in finding the determinant was basically a swapping rows, which is swapping linear constraints, or it was adding a multiple of a constraint to another constraint, which doesn't change anything. The only new piece here is that there is this column vector called y. And as I am operating on row pairs of A, I also have to operate on the corresponding pairs of y elements. Okay. So again, we can use our earlier process to turn A into an upper triangular matrix. Okay. This is what we do in Gaussian elimination. We turn A into an upper triangular matrix. We transform y simultaneously. At the end, we need to add code to manipulate rows of y in sync with rows of a. Now we can solve it backwards. We find xn minus 1, then xn minus 2, and backward to x1. And the equations are x0, and the equations are very simple. So our final matrix is square, and it looks like that upper triangular thing. And here is a, here is x after transformations, and here is y. Okay. So obviously xn minus 1 is just equal to yn minus 1 divided by an minus 1 n minus 1. And then for the general case, what we have is aii xi plus aii plus 1 xi plus 1 plus etc. plus an minus 1 xn minus 1 is equal to yi. Right, so you run down the ith row, okay, from I to n minus 1, from I to n minus 1, and you get yi. Okay. Now if you solve for that, it's quite easy to see that I can solve it backwards. And my expression for xi is simply yi minus sum over this quantity aij xij divided by aii. We're just directly solving that. So the code looks like this. So if A has already been turned to upper triangular and Y is available and X is allocated, this part of the code is quite easy. So I run from IX down from size minus 1 to 0. Okay. Remember, here XI depends on all larger XJs. Okay. XI depends on all XJ where J is larger than I. I'm solving downward from the highest index downward, right? So I initialize xi to yi, and then j runs from I plus 1 to size, and I directly implement this equation. I initialize to yi, I keep subtracting aij xj, and finally I divide by aii. I'm just avoiding allocating a new variable. I stored all the intermediate results in xi itself. So everyone okay with this? The only missing piece which I haven't discussed in detail is this red line, which is code to manipulate rows of y in sync with A. Now observe that unlike diagonals, when we swap two rows, that's like swapping two linear constraints, equalities. And I don't have to remember anything. Interchanging the position of two linear constraints doesn't change the system at all. Okay, I just need to swap the corresponding yi's also. That's all. So in writing the code, it helps if we, I'll write it from scratch just so that no one gets lost. Okay. So, but I'll have my cheat sheet handy to cut and paste, but we'll discuss everything as we cut and paste. So first, all the prelude stuff which doesn't matter. Now, the first thing we'll do is create a stub function called make upper triangular, okay? And let's see. So I'll start with the file being essentially nothing. So we'll see that everything works out. Okay, so in doing coding using modularity, like declaring functions and using them, it often helps if you start typing out the main method pretending that you have all the supporting libraries. See, earlier when you used to code by using square root and log and exp, we assumed someone else had written them for you. It's good to keep coding in that style, pretending that someone has already coded make upper triangular for us and then fill in the details. So what do? We declare a matrix called A. We read this in from CN. And we write it out just for verification. Okay. Now we invoke upper triangular on A and Y. Remember, we also have to pass in Y. So let's say Y is a vector of doubles. We read in Y and we print it out as well. So remember the first input to this problem. So main does the following: solve AX equal to Y, right? So here we input A, okay? Now we input Y, now we make A upper triangular while transforming Y in corresponding ways, and then we write it out. Okay, so we code part by part. Now how do we make things upper triangular? Well, here we go. So what is this stuff? So I'm saying that I'm declaring a function called make upper triangular, where the first argument is a matrix of doubles, the second argument is a matrix of is a vector of doubles. Okay. Now let's do one thing. Let's not do anything at all in make upper triangular. Let's just compile it and run. I will submit one A and one Y. So what is my input look like? So I've written out in boost format A, which is a 3x3 non-singular matrix, and Y, which is a 3x1 column vector. Okay, this is A, that's Y. I'll read them both in from that file and just print them out, and I'll run make upper triangular, but nothing will be done inside it. This is a good way to start developing code. So I compile that and then I run given that data file. So what happens? It says A was that file. So for comparison, I'll just print out the original files themselves. So A was 1, 2, 4, 2, 4, 6, 3, 5, 7. Okay, so sure enough, A is 3x3, 1, 2, 4, 2, 4, 6, 3, 5, 7. Y is 21, 34, 42. Now I didn't do anything inside the make upper triangular. So the upper triangular matrix is exactly identical to A. Nothing has happened, right? Now let's try one thing. Inside this, I'll just say A 0, 0. equals minus 100. So I'm not really doing upper triangularization, I'm just mangling one element of A to an arbitrary value just to check what happens. So if I compile this again, suppose I print this out, I'll say inside make upper triangular A equals, and then I print A. So all I did is, this is test code, I'm not really coding what's required. I have passed A and Y as inputs to this function. I'm just changing A00 to a value, and I'm just printing out A as I see it. Okay. Now, if I compile this, and I run, what do I find? Inside make upper triangular, A33 has become minus 100 in place of 124. So that's because I changed A00 to minus 100. But when I reach outside, it's back to 1. Okay? And that's because C and C++ pass parameters by value, meaning that this A, when I call make upper triangular on A and Y, it actually makes a copy of A, it makes a copy of Y, and passes those copies into the function. What I do to those variables inside the function stay within the function. When the function exits, there is no direct way of communicating those changes to the outside world if I pass parameters like this. Okay? The correct way to do it in this case, if you want to change A and Y for the outside world, is to pass it by what's called reference. So this ampersand sign tells the compiler to not make a copy. It tells the compiler that whatever changes happen to A inside this routine will be percolated outside, even if you call it something else, like we can call it B, and we can now say B00 equal to 100, okay? And then I can call all of these B's. But this ampersand makes sure that the changes are actually happening to the matrix outside. It's just a name change, it's not a copy of values. So this time if I compile this, and I run that, this time you see that even after the return, the so-called upper triangular matrix actually has the change reflected in the diagonal element. So because make upper triangular will obviously make changes to A and Y, I should declare it with the ampersand. Okay? So let me rename it to A because my other code is like that, and I'll take out this test code. Okay. Now let's put in our upper triangular code in it. So what do I have to do for upper triangularization? So here is the body of the code that does the upper triangularization. Again, remember that the initial, I want to have the dx loop to start with. Then I have the sx loop for the subtractions, and I have the cx loop for the columns as I subtract. Again, if I see that pivoting is required, I'll find a lower row z. Okay. Now the important thing is here, as I run through the columns, I'm subtracting fact times a sx cx from a. I have to do the same thing with y. Okay. So to give you the picture here, I want to zero all this out. Okay. Here is sx, an earlier row. Okay. Between sx and dx, I found a factor, fac, so that I have to subtract a. So a dx, comma star, should become a dx, comma star, minus fac times a sx, comma everything. That's the operation I want. Now obviously what I'm doing is, actually this was A, that was X, and I was saying AX equal to Y. So I need to extend DX and SX here. And I also want to subtract fact times YSX from YDX. I'm transforming both sides of the equation, otherwise the equation will be violated, right? So I also have to do YDX minus equal to fact times y s x. Okay? And that's exactly what you see in this line here. So after I am done with the column loop, I also fix up the y guys. Similarly, if I see that pivoting and swap is required, I swap rows dx and z. I do that not only for a, but I have to do it for y as well. Those are the only two changes. And then dx has to be reduced like before. Okay. So this is the code for make upper triangular. And once the matrix has become upper triangular, I can solve upper triangular, where someone has given me an upper triangular matrix and a transformed y, and I'll output the solution x. Okay. And this is the same code that we saw in this expression. This expression is directly implemented in this subroutine. Okay. We'll review this again, but let me just quickly run this. So how is the call sequence look like? First, I make a and y upper triangular, or a upper triangular, and then I allocate the new vector x, and then I solve upper triangular by passing it a, y, and x is output from it. And then I print out x. So I'll compile the old code, Gaussian.cpp. And now if I run this, giving it the Gaussian data set, okay, you see that a was 1, 2, 4, 2, 4, 6, 3, 5, 7, y was 21, 34, 42. After upper triangularization, it becomes 1, 2, 4, 0, -1, -5, 0, 0, -2. And then x can be solved to 3, 1, 4. You can verify that. Okay. So that is Gaussian elimination.